Hello, I'm Marilyn Priel, your host for The Better Part. For this program, we're going to show you some old-time farm equipment and tell you about a group of hobbyists who established a museum to display and maintain it. Stay tuned.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program that encompasses a diverse spectrum of topics important to our community, which we hope will both inform and entertain you. We invite you to sit back and enjoy the program.
Our guest is John Kegebine, spearhead of the Agricultural History Project in Watsonville, California. Thanks for being here with us, John.
Thank you for coming and inviting me to be part of this. Mm-hmm.
You know, I was out here at the fairgrounds last year, and I just love seeing all this old antique equipment. And I vowed I'd come back and do a program.
Yeah.
And I called you a couple of months ago.
Right.
And lo and behold, you'd built a museum and a huge shop to do all the repairs.
Right.
And you even had a social organization established to raise some funds
right.
and help support it.
Right.
How did all that come about? Was that your idea?
Well, we go back to the concept of having an agriculture museum here in the fairgrounds. It goes back to 1967, when Hubert Wyckoff of the Parle Valley Historical Association had the dream of doing a pioneer village and a museum to preserve the history of agriculture in the Central Coast of California. We had started putting the program together, and then in about 1970, management changed here, and the interest seemed to be losing. There was no interest, but in the meantime, we had a large collection of equipment. So I kind of clung on to a few things here while I was working here, tried to preserve them, and then I left in 1984, and in 1986, I got a bunch of people together that I knew were interested. And then we started a nonprofit organization called the Agriculture History Project. And from that, we've got our goals, we set our mission statement. And basically, we want to preserve the history of agriculture on the Central Coast. It's very rich, and there's a lot of history here, and a lot of food has come from this valley to go all over the world to feed people. In 1987, then after we got our nonprofit status, we started looking for a site. We looked at 10 different places in the area, and we ended up selecting the Santa Cruz County Fairgrounds.
What a wonderful place right. for it.
And the board of directors at that time accepted us, and right off the bat, they felt that there'd be no better place to present the history of agriculture.
A real asset.
Right.
So. Where they're showing all their produce right. and everything that
right.
was grown.
So from that, then this site that we're presently sitting on here basically was a piece of ground that was a little park in front, and the rest of it was just hillside off the racetrack. I mean, it was weeds. In 1994 then, we got a bunch of volunteers together, and we leveled the site. And then 1996, Bernice Porter, donated the money to start the Porter building over here, and that's when we took off. And since that time, then we've had fundraisers, and we've contacted people, and people have actually sent us money because they also are supportive of what we're doing.
Mm-hmm.
And we built this building here last year, the Snyder Building.
The restoration barn
we uh-huh. built last year.
So
this year now we've built the gazebo and the amphitheater and the lawns, and then next year we build the main museum.
You mean this one over here is not the main?
No, we broke ground in May,
mm-hmm.
and we got the pad leveled about 3 weeks ago, and then January we hope to have all the plans approved and everything ready to go. And that'll be our next building project.
I'm astounded. Seems like I know you've been working on it a long time,
right.
but it seems like that it happened overnight.
From
the last time I was here.
Yeah, we felt that we were comfortable that we could move ahead. Everybody started working towards that common goal of getting this developed and online.
Mm-hmm.
And we had heard it was going to take us 15 years, and the 15th year will be when we open the museum.
Really? Well.
So that's neat. So.
Well, you're kind of a hero then, aren't you?
No.
For sticking with it and doing all that.
Yeah, I think we got a number of people that stuck with it from the beginning. But, yeah.
You have an amazing amount of farm machinery and tools and things. Right. Now, how did you acquire all that?
Most of the people just call us to give it to. There is not a piece of equipment out here that we have bought. It's all been donated to us. We're now starting to restore some of the equipment. Last year, there was four tractors here that were sitting along the fence over there just rusting away, and this year we pulled them in the shop. And the man that just walked by here, Ray Gernert, he started to volunteer in June, and he just come in here and has been restoring tractors and getting them running. And this year we have 13 tractors running now, compared to seven last year.
They all work. I mean,
they all work.
You put probably names of donors. You've got little stamps.
We try to recognize our donors. Mm-hmm. And we also try to recognize the people that help us restore the equipment. Mm-hmm. And then in some of this literature, I try to put some of the history of the literature so people can see what it was used for or read about it or stuff.
What you've done since I was here for the groundbreaking, a couple months ago, what you've done since then, I'm amazed.
Well, we were very fortunate. We have a lot of support in the community. The gazebo is an example. While starting first, this particular project where we're sitting in here was all accomplished through one donation from one lady in Watsonville, Cornelia Modesto. Her family, it's a large background of history with that family. They've been here probably for many, many years.
Hispanic?
And they were, no.
Oh,
they
not.
Were Yugoslavs who came, settled in the area, and started growing apples. And they were one of the apple growers and shippers.
Oh.
And, so anyway, she wanted to have something in their memory left, so she gave us a large donation. And from that donation, we was able to pour about 250 yards of concrete. We was able to buy the bleachers, the lawn, the block wall, which we started last January, and then the gazebo. And then Freedom Rotary Club in Watsonville came and helped us assemble the gazebo.
Wow.
So we had a lot of community support to make all this happen here.
And then the people who restore this equipment, are they former mechanics or are they former tractor owners?
Ray over there is a former farmer. He was born and raised on a farm. Became an airplane mechanic.
Wow.
Got tired of fixing airplanes, so he came out here and started helping us fix tractors.
Just loves it, huh? So. And you have not just tractors, but you have old wagons.
Right.
Looks like Model A Ford pickup.
We have a 1934 Ford pickup that we restored this year. Mm-hmm. We had the Santa Cruz County ROP program, which is at the Sheriff Rehab. They have a body shop, and they restored that truck for us.
Wow.
We would like to have more wagons and buggies. I mean, that's kind of our focus because we want to preserve the past. And when we started this thing probably about 30 years too late, because a lot of the buggies and things like that it's either in collector's hands or in. Mm-hmm. But we do have a few wagons and buggies, and we restored a wagon. I have it, it's not here today. We restored a 1930 lettuce wagon last year.
Mm.
I think I had it out here for the dedication, but they're using it in the harvest building this year to display produce on it, so.
Okay.
But
I imagine that some of these people who collected items maybe will in their will leave some of this to you.
Yeah,
but it must be a big thrill to a farmer to see his tractor
donated
come over and say, I remember I used to drive this around.
Right. And we have that. I mean, yesterday someone offered us a tractor from Madera. So, I mean, people also want to see some of their old equipment preserved too.
Mm-hmm.
So,
Well, could you show us around
and
explain what some of these things do? This one looks a little more.
Right. In the 30s and 40s, maybe even into the 50s, a lot of pole beans were grown in the Paro Valley. That's before the time of the bush beans that we grow now. And the pole beans had to have poles, and they had to have strings strung on them. And this machine, I don't know totally how it works, but someone gave it to us, and it actually was used to strings so the pole beans could grow on those strings.
Well, for goodness sake.
So that's one of the unusual pieces of equipment we have that's mainly manufactured for this area.
This stuff is so ingenious. Right. The designs are really fascinating to me. Okay, let's move on to the next one.
Okay.
What's this pretty orange and yellow one?
This orange and yellow is a fertilizer spreader used probably in the 1930s in an apple orchard where East Lake Shopping Center is now located on 152 in Watsonville. The spreader was given to the Agriculture History Project so that we could preserve some of the history, the local history of the area. And this wagon was in the collector's hands and they couldn't sell it, so they gave it to us.
When would that, about what time period
would
that
have been? It would probably be the time period between the 20s and the 30s,
really?
40s, in that period of time, because it was converted to tractor. Originally it was used by horses. It had the short, long pole, and then they put the short metal pole in there for tractor. So it was used by horses.
It has a wooden base, doesn't it?
Right, right.
So, and then this one over here?
And the piece on the left with the tubes, that is a duster that when the lettuce industry was developed in the area, why one of the insecticides that they used on the lettuce was DDT. And so this machine was designed to spray DDT on the lettuce, and right where the apple box is sitting there is where a motor was. And it was pulled, this particular machine was pulled by a tractor. Some of them were also made with the pulled by horses. This DDT is no longer used, but it's an artifact that kind of tells that part of history of agriculture.
It's so much fun to see the wooden boxes instead of cardboard.
Right. That box really don't belong there, but
it's just for
effect. It's there. It's just happened to be put there yesterday probably by someone.
Okay. And then this one down here with the kind of jagged
That's a hay mower. Again, that's a machine. It was designed to cut hay. That's a McCormick Dering machine. That machine was originally used for designed to be pulled by horses. And in the 40s, when tractors became very popular, they put a metal pole in there and they started pulling it with a tractor.
And this little green one over here is kind of interesting.
This is a tractor pole. You can put various implements on that, and then you can either cultivate or you can rip the soil, dig the soil, or whatever. That's pulled by a tractor. This is the latest machine in our collection of antique farm equipment. It is a bean thresher, approximate age of 110 years old. It was manufactured by the Owens Company, and the last known record of that company was 1901. This is made of wood with the metal concaves and things inside, and we're quite proud to be able to receive an implement like this in our collection that is in the condition it is for the age.
Well, this looks like some heavy-duty equipment here. What's this all about?
This is a hay press. About in the 1890s to 1920s, farmers were looking for better ways to move their hay, bale their hay, handle their hay for the feed for their cattle, so that the manufacturers designed a machine called a hay press. And this is basically a stationary press where it would be pulled out into the field, and then all the hay, loose hay, would be brought to it, and then a farmer in this particular case would take and pitch the hay into the machine. On the back side over here, we'd pitch the hay into the machine, and then the machine would make bales. We don't have the blocks for this machine, but you would take and drop a block in here into this part here, and it would drop down in there. And then you would take, and when the block came through where you could see it, you would poke a wire through. And then you would reverse it, and that's how you'd make your bales.
So you actually wired it up and everything with one machine?
Wired it up and everything. What's unique about this machine is that it was dropped here at our doorstep one day by someone. We don't know who. This is probably the only piece of equipment that we don't have recorded who donated it to us. But they knew that we were preserving some of the farm machinery and practices, so they brought it here. And we went and cleaned it up, and this is the first year, actually probably in the last 40 years, that this thing baled hay. And it's running good. We'll bale it up, and I'll show you in a few moments how it operates.
Okay.
But this machine is made by McCormick Dering Company out of Chicago, Illinois, probably in the 30s, maybe even 1920, I don't know.
It's a little old piece of wood there.
Right, yeah. These were actually come custom to, from the factory, just the way they're bolted up. Huh. So it'll make it easier for the farmer to pitch the hay in it. Okay. This is a grain threshing machine. The machine right now is in transport position, but when it's operating, this apron here would be slung out, and then the bundles of grain would be put into that machine, and they would work their way through the machine with various shakers and knives to remove all the grain from the machine. The grain would go through the top where it is a pre-cleaner. When the grain is finished, comes out of this machine, it is ready for human consumption. On the far side, you'll see a little bit of the straw chute. Straw will go then on a pile. From there, a farmer would probably bale it. This machine was the last known machine to be used in the Parral Valley in Santa Cruz County. It threshed grain all along the Highway 1 corridor from Moss Landing to Aptos, probably at one time or another. It was given to us by the Rehrman family, and we hope to one day be able to restore it in its entirety and operate it.
What's this funny looking?
This is a hay loader. This is a loose hay loader. Prior to baling hay, the farmers had to get the hay onto a wagon so they could haul it to the barn from the field. And this particular, they would make a windrow, and then the machine would be pulled up the middle of the windrow, and the hay would then, these forks keep moving.
What's this one, John, with the big barrel?
This tractor is a Titan 10-10-20. It was the first tractor many farmers owned. The tractor replaced a horse. It's manufactured by International Harvester Company, and this up until this time, International had not produced a tractor. These were manufactured between 1915 and 1922. And they actually was 78,000 of these tractors manufactured.
Really? My goodness. And where were, I'm just wondering about this now.
Okay.
But how large of factories would they have? How many would they produce in a year's time?
Well,
do you have any idea?
If you divided that by 7 years, they probably produced, 10,000, 11,000 tractors a year.
Per year?
On this particular.
Okay.
But you also have to remember International Harvester was also manufacturing many other implements. This is a road grader. Now, I don't know the name of the road grader, but I do know that this road grader was one of the graders that built Highway 152 right past the fairgrounds. Up from the mountains to the top of the mountains down here, they said that this road grader was used to grade the roads. For the first roads.
It's
that were
a real grown. Historical.
It's a real historical piece. We're proud to have it here because it's part of close to the history of how things were developed in this area.
Okay, and then this the horse. What do you call this thing
now,
again?
The next door is a horse-drawn. This was given to us about a month ago. This is a horse-powered hay press. It's the same as the first one you've seen over there, only the horse goes around in a circle, in a big circle, and they actually...
I've seen those in the Middle East,
right,
where they walk
right,
around in a circle
right.
like that.
This is the first piece of equipment we have like that in our collection.
Oh,
now.
For goodness sake.
So this is one that we're going to hopefully start working on within the next year or two to restore.
Well, that would have been really old one, wouldn't it?
Yeah, this goes back to the teens. Probably the turn of the century. Hmm. The machine next to it on the far right there was also a machine that was used in the valley here, and they would bale hay and press hay all the way to King City. But that particular one has a derrick where you dump big wads of hay in there at a time to compress it.
So it worked faster.
Yeah, it worked faster, yeah. Mm-hmm. And it would work by an engine here. We've had it belted up by a tractor.
By an engine, would it have been just gasoline engine?
Gasoline engines, mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's prior to the diesel.
Mm-hmm. They started the tractor-driven power saw.
Okay, now this is the temporary museum, which is still impressive to me, but it looks like you have a lot of dairy.
Right, we have a lot of dairy.
Here.
This building was donated to us with the intent of preserving implements, but being that we did not have a place to start telling our story, we asked the donor to let us start developing some of our displays and tell some history of some of the things that we have preserved. And the one thing was our dairy collection. In 1991, we received a large dairy collection of bottles, artifacts of all types from Monte Del Carlo and Pat Campbell. They both had deceased, and in their will, they had left this to us. We have about 60% of it displayed, 60 to 80%, I don't know. We got a number of bottles yet still boxed up. Santa Cruz County had over 152 dairies at one time, commercial dairies. Today there is none. The displays you see in here and the bottles and stuff come from dairies within Santa Cruz County. And we try to preserve some of that history. Mm-hmm. And many of the artifacts also came from Santa Cruz County, but I don't know if they all. With the milk cans and stuff don't have names on them, so we don't know if they actually were used in Santa Cruz County or it came from someplace else.
It's fun looking at all the labels and things up here too.
A lot of the companies are still in business. One of them, there was De La Valve that still manufactures and still makes dairy equipment. I'm not sure about some of the other. Carnation, we know Carnation is still around, so there we have. And we've also made this exhibit educational. You'll see a bunch of milk bottles. He's pointing, I think he's got one in the focus right there. Those milk bottles, we have a question on top of what is the, like this one is, what is the most common dairy breed in California? And then on the bottom is the answer.
Oh, so, okay. That's nice. So this is really, do you have a lot of school children coming through here?
Yes, we have, starting January 15th, 2000, we're going to be inviting school classes to come in here, and we'll actually have a program together that the classes can learn about the history of agriculture and also some of the present and the practices, and they can participate. We have cows here they can milk. We'll have some wooden cows. They're not real cows yet, but they're not in this building. They're in the actually about 2 o'clock today, we'll invite the kids to come in and actually milk those cows. We did that all
by
through
hand?
The fair, by hand, right. And then we have, in fact, I can bring one of those out and you and I can be, you know, we can
go ahead. Can I milk?
And we can go
can
and milk.
I milk a cow?
And then we're going to, you know, have some grain planting, and then we got some butter making, and we're going to have a number of things where the children can do. We hope to make it a 2 to 3 hour experience for them
Wonderful.
To come out here. During the fair here and throughout the year when we have children here, these cows are part of the demonstration area that we use. And what we do is we let a child, two children, participate. One they get a chance to practice a little bit. Then we give them 1 minute, and the one that milks the most milk in 1 minute then gets a blue ribbon when they attend the fair. So we're going to do this now. Merrill and I are going to milk these cows, and I'll take Bessie over here, and you can take Bossie.
Okay.
And we're going to see if we can milk a cow.
Okay. Any instructions on how to do this?
Well, have you ever milked a cow?
No.
Oh, you haven't. Then I'll give you some instructions. I thought maybe you had.
Okay,
basically you hold the teat in your hand like this, and you squeeze.
Okay, all right.
And then you just go.
You don't pull or anything.
Just squeeze.
Okay.
Squeeze from the top down.
Right. So do I have to fill up this whole bucket?
Well, we're going to find out. Until that runs dry. No. We're only going to do this for about
until
a minute.
Until she runs dry?
Isn't that long enough?
Okay.
1 minute?
All right.
Okay. Whenever
ready?
You're ready.
Ready? Go.
Oh, you're doing it. You're a pretty good milkmaid there. I think you've got enough footage by now.
Okay. That's fun. John, if someone wanted to donate some time or contribute money or become involved in your social organization that raises funds, who would they contact? How would they go about it?
They can contact the Agriculture History Project. We have an office here that we have an answering machine on. The area code is 831-724-5898. Or they, if they want to talk to me personally, they can call me at home, 831-722-0362.
Okay, very good. Thank you so much for preserving all this old-time equipment. The younger generation appreciates it, and the old-timers do, too. It's really been fun coming out here.
I appreciate you coming by and helping us with this.
Great.
Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed being with us today. We certainly enjoy the program. If you have any ideas for future shows that you would like to watch, let us know. Or if you would like to be a member of the crew, you can contact the Cupertino Senior Center. Thanks for coming.